So last week we started a two-part series. How many remember what the title was? Anybody remember? Yes, Pastor Jesse.
My commitment to walk in love.
My commitment to walk in love. We started a part one last week for Christmas, and we're doing a part two this week for New Year's. Amen. My commitment to walk in love is the title of the series. It's only going to be a two-part. Today is the final installment. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, when we hear about the word commitment, we all know what that means. I'm going to be committed to this. I'm going to be committed to that. I'm going to stay committed to my workout. I'm going to stay committed. We all know what the word means, but I was led to look it up in the dictionary. And in the dictionary, let me tell you what the word commitment means. I love the definition. It means to be responsible for. It means to pledge. And it means to obligate oneself. I'm going to say that again. The word commitment, according to the dictionary, is defined as to be responsible for, to obligate oneself, or to pledge. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Last week when we opened up our series, we went to Matthew chapter 1 and chapter 2. We read the Christmas story, so to speak, in those chapters instead of going to Luke chapter 2, because from Matthew's perspective, we had a little bit of a different twist on the way he relayed the story about the birth of Jesus. In Matthew 1 and 2, we saw the greatest example of that commitment to love, and that was when the Father sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to the earth by the way of a virgin named Mary. Everybody remember that? That's the greatest love story ever told. Brother C.T. said that. This is the greatest love story ever told. That's the greatest love story ever told in the Bible, is when Jesus came to the earth. Amen. And then we saw another example. And some of you said, I've never heard it like that before, Pastor, after the service last week. Joseph, Mary's husband, you know that he was wanting to divorce Mary because she was pregnant. Everybody know that. He wanted to leave Mary. He wanted to either, she was pregnant, but there was no real explanation of how she got pregnant to the people in the earth. You couldn't explain spiritual things back then. So here's Mary's pregnant. Joseph is faced with a decision. My wife is pregnant. I'm not the father because we haven't consummated our marriage yet. I need to make a decision. I need to leave. I need to expose her maybe to the Jewish authorities. She might get stoned. I'm faced with a difficult decision. But the decision he made was to stay rooted and grounded and stay with his wife Mary, even though he knew he was going to face some extreme difficult times because of the birth of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How many of you know that they were scrutinized publicly, Joseph and Mary? They were mocked, they were ridiculed, they were talked about, they were stared at. Did y'all know that they went through that? Everybody talks about the precious Jesus baby in the manger, but no one knows. No one really knows exactly what Mary and Joseph went through. Joseph wanted to run in fear, but no, he didn't run from love. He didn't run when the things got tough. He stayed put, stayed with Mary. How many know, how was it possible for him to do that? Because God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. I'm going to say that again. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. How many know that when you make a commitment to walk in love, you're going to feel empowered?
Amen.
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 Let me tell you, you can't love outside of the Holy Spirit, though.
Amen. Come on now.
You need the help of the Holy Spirit, which brings us to the second part of our message. It is possible to love the way God loves. It's called an agape love, a God kind of love. That's what we're talking about today. It's a love outside of our own strength. You need the help of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Come on.
And we're going to read about that. Everybody turn with me to Romans chapter 5. You can't love in the flesh. The arm of flesh will fail you. The only way you can make this commitment to love is with the help of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God sent an angel to Joseph because he was fixing to make a really bad decision. But how many know God doesn't send us angels to give us messages today? Why? Because Jesus Christ went to the cross and he said, if I don't go, I can't send the comforter. We have the Holy Spirit. He's our helper. He's our counselor. He's our guide. He's our everything. He's the one that leads us. The Bible says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. When you decide to walk in the Spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. If you decide to walk in the Spirit, you're going to be able to love in the Spirit. Your love walk is going to not be so anemic. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Some of our love walks are a little anemic. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. I don't know how long this message is going to be, but it wasn't going to, I don't think it's going to be very long, but I usually say that and it's usually long. But I don't think it's going to be long, but praise God, there's so much meat in here, and I want to, we're going to be teaching you topically today. It's called a topical sermon, which means I normally teach from the book of Genesis, which we took a break from that so we can bring this message in for the holidays and for the season. It's usually an exegetic teaching. It's line by line, staying in the same area. But today, we're going to do a topical sermon, which means you move from book to book. So we're going to be moving around just a little in the New Testament today. Amen?
Amen.
Romans chapter 5, starting at verse 5. You know, I'm actually go to, let's go to verse 3. I'm going to start there. It says, we can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, for we know that they help us develop endurance. How many of you know that when you're in a trial, doesn't matter what kind of trial it is, if the enemy has come to assail you in some way or come to attack you and throw his fiery darts, or he's come to seek to kill, to steal, and to destroy, how many know that we have an advocate with the Father?
Yes.
Through the blood of Jesus, amen?
Amen.
That we have that right to ask Jesus, the Lord Jesus. That's our right and our privileges to ask the Lord to help us go through that. Amen?
Amen.
But when we go through that trial, when that trial is over, don't we come out? You ever notice when you come out of a major trial that you come out a little more humble? You come out a little more loving, a little more kind, a little more meek, a little more less critical, a little less judgmental? I can tell you, I'm a melancholy, and before I really was overtaken by the Holy Ghost, I was very analytical. I was very critical. I was very judgmental. How many know that was a weakness in my temperament? And over the years, I've had to ask God to help me temper that out.
Hallelujah.
Unforgiveness. Oh, that was a big one for me. Holding on to wrongs. Very, very big one. But through trials, oh boy, I've been through some trials. Through trials over the years, every time I come out of the trial on the other side, I might be have had a little smoke, but I didn't get burned. Amen?
Amen.
I was a little more humble. I was a little more nice. I was a little more friendly. And so trials does teach us some things.
Amen.
And what it does, let me tell you, verse 4, I'm going to tell you what it does here. And endurance, when you have that endurance, church, it develops strength of character.
Hallelujah.
And character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. Who's the hope of our salvation? Jesus Christ. He made the way when there seemed to be no way. Amen?
Yeah.
Verse 5. And this hope will not lead to disappointment. When you put your hope in Jesus Christ, it doesn't lead to disappointment. When you put your hope in people, you're always going to be disappointed. Because the arm of flesh will fail you.
Amen?
Amen. But Jesus Christ, our hope, He will never fail us.
Come on now.
That's why we always tell you, in this ministry, we point you to Jesus. We point you to Jesus. We don't point you to us, unless, of course, you know, you need counseling, whatever. But we always point you to Jesus first. And then, if you go into prayer, or if you seek the Lord, and you need something from Him, and you've already sought Him, then you say, well, I need a little counseling now. And that's where we come in. Amen?
Amen.
So, the hope in Jesus Christ, our hope in Him, will never lead to disappointment. And it goes on to say this, for we know how dearly God loves us. Do you all know how much God loves you?
Hallelujah.
It's a love that I'll never be able to understand, and we're going to get to that in a minute. I'll never be able to understand, but as pastors, we get to scratch the surface of that kind of love. Why? Because as pastors, we have to love people even though people don't love us. We have to love people even though people come against us. We love people even though they talk about us, talk about our ministry, talk about whatever. We have to love. And you know what? We do it not in our own strength, but in the strength of the Holy Ghost. And it's a love. Everything we do in this ministry, from the door to the back to wherever, any part of this ministry, we do it with a motivation of love.
Amen.
We wouldn't be here if we didn't love. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
So it goes on to say, for we know how dearly God loves us, because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. It's only by the way of the Holy Spirit that He can begin to form that fruit of love. If you're disconnected from the Spirit, that love will be stifled.
Amen?
Amen. I'm going to say that again. If you're disconnected from the Spirit of God, your love stifled. It's going to go as far as the ceiling, and it's going to come right back down to the floor.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
That's
good. So, well, we know how dearly God loves us because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. And we said it last week in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believeth in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Hallelujah!
Praise the Lord!
Woo! That's a love that, like I said, we're just scratching the surface of. We cannot understand that kind of love that God gave us through Jesus. But we keep on striving. We keep on going from glory to glory. We keep on going from strength to strength. Our love that we have as the body of Christ does not give up. We don't give up. Amen?
Amen.
And Jesus, I mean, he said, if I don't go, I can't send the Comforter. I said that a while ago. But the Holy Ghost is here to comfort us. The Holy Ghost is here to help us. The Holy Ghost is here to guide us in love and with people. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody turn with me to go to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. We need the Holy Spirit to help us in our commitment to walk in love. It's a commitment that's you're gonna have to put yourself aside for this kind of commitment. You're gonna have to give up some of yourself for this kind of commitment to love. Amen. It can't be me, the way I feel, the way I is, self. No, and I think Joyce Meyer said, what about me? What about me? What about me? I always remember that forever for Joyce Meyer. What about me? What about me? We have to stop being a what about me body of Christ. Amen?
That's right.
We have to start saying, what about them? What about her? What about him? What about that brother? What about that sister? Ooh. How can I encourage somebody? Can I throw them an email? Can I throw them a text? Hey, I love you. You know, I'm praying for you. Something. Hallelujah. That's the way we walk in love as a body. Hallelujah. So Ephesians chapter 3, let's start at verse 14. At the top of your New Living Translations, it says, Paul's prayer for spiritual growth. Everybody read that? Most of your Bible should have that. Verse 14. When I think of all this, I fall to my knees and pray to the Father, the creator of everything in heaven and on earth. Hallelujah. You know how much Apostle Paul loved God? Everybody know about Apostle Paul? He killed Christians thinking he was doing something for God. And then he was transformed. And he was Saul and he became Paul. And look how much Paul loved him. If Paul can fall in love with God and he came from being a murderer, how much more can God do with us? Now that we have Jesus that went to the cross, seated at the right hand of the Father, and we have the Holy Ghost in the earth. Amen. Amen. And he says here, I pray that from his glorious, unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his Spirit. Through his Spirit. The Lord says some of you need inner strength. Some of you are anemic in some areas spiritually. The Lord has put many of you in our hearts to pray, to go. Like Abraham was praying for Lot, praying and interceding the way Jesus intercedes on our behalf. That's a love. God loves us so much. Amen.
Amen.
Apostle Paul loved God's people. He loved the Lord, and he wanted to make a difference. And here it says, I pray that from his glorious unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his Spirit. But if you're not walking in the Spirit, how are you going to be strengthened? If you're walking in the flesh, you're going to be a miserable Christian.
Amen.
You're going to be very unhappy. Amen.
Amen.
Well, Pastor, how do I walk in the Spirit? Spend time in the Word. Spend time in prayer. Spend time around the body of Christ. This is where we draw strength from the body.
Amen.
Amen. Then it says, then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. How many of you know that the Holy Spirit is the one who helps form Jesus Christ in our heart? That's why we need him. He's the one that helps us develop the fruit of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit does. Amen.
Hallelujah.
We need him. It says, then Christ will make his home in your heart as you trust in him. It says here, your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. How many know a person that walks in love and makes a commitment to walk in love, their roots grow down deep and they're not shifted. A storm can come and the tree's roots that go all the way down. A storm or hurricane comes and that tree just bends, but the roots go down so deep it doesn't fall. That's the kind of Christians God wants us to be. That's the kind of love God wants us to have for each other, for each and every person here. And also, how do they know us? By showing, by our fruit. How do we know them? We shall know them by their fruit. We're the ones that need to have the fruit so we can take the love to the lost and the dying. Amen?
Amen.
A lost and dying world.
Amen.
And it says here, and may you have the power to understand as all God's people should. Oh, I love this. How wide, how long, how high and how deep his love is. You ever seen a little baby? Give me a big hug. And they go, they give you a hug. They say, give me a big hug. Give me bigger. And they go, oh, that's how much God loves us. And he wants us to understand that love so that we can love others. The more you understand God's love for you, the more you can pour out love for others. Amen? Amen. Love you wide. I love you long, Lord. Long suffering. How many of the fruit of the Spirit? Long suffering. Fruit of the Spirit. No matter what circumstances are going on, I'm going to love you, Lord. I'm going to serve you, Lord. I'm going to make my commitment to walk in love with you and with your people. Amen?
Amen.
And it says here, and may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, past the ceiling, all the way to heaven. Amen. How deep this love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. We'll never understand how God decided to send his son, how he made a commitment thousands of years ago that we know. And in the book of Genesis, all the way to the book of Malachi, he kept promising a savior through the prophets, kept promising, I'm going to send my son. I'm going to send a son to my son through a virgin named Mary. And he kept his promise, and it was fulfilled in the Gospels. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's how much God loved us. Thousands and thousands of years old, that plan was. And he kept his commitment to walk in love for us when we were undone. Amen.
Amen.
It says, then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. And before I switch out of this scripture, I want you to understand a sign of spiritual growth is when your love begins to mature. When you're not spiritually growing, that means your love walk has been stifled somewhere. Amen. Everybody understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
A sign of spiritual growth is that your character is being developed. And when your character is being developed, then you'll be able to love people. As you abide in him, his love will abide in you. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Everybody go with me to Philippians chapter 1. I told you we were going to go topically today. Scripture to scripture. It's really good scriptures. They're easy to understand. Hallelujah. A commitment to walk in love. I am making a commitment today, God, the Father, Jesus, Holy Ghost, before my fellow brethren, before my pastors, I'm making a commitment today to walk in love. The way Apostle Paul walked in love. We want to be. He was flesh and blood. He wasn't a spirit. He wasn't God. He was a man. And he loved outside of his own strength, because he had help from the Holy Spirit. He understood that.
Hallelujah.
Philippians chapter 1, starting at verse 9. Everybody with me. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
I pray that your what?
Love.
Your love. I pray that your love will overflow more and more, and that you will keep on growing what? In knowledge and understanding. It all goes hand in hand. Your spiritual growth is a reflection of how much you love. Your love is a reflection of your spiritual growth. Let's put it that way. Let's go backwards. Your love that you have for one another is a reflection of your spiritual growth.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I pray that your love will overflow more and more. When I read the scripture, I thought about a song we sang last Sunday. We did a different version of it. We did the Michael W. Smith. It was More Love, More Power. I really like that version. We found it. It's beautiful, beautiful version. And it was More Love, More Power. More love, more power. When you have more love, how many know that you're empowered?
That's
you're
right.
Empowered, not in your own self, but you're empowered by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I love that song because it's so true. I pray that your love will overflow more and more, and that you will keep on growing in knowledge and understanding. That's our prayer for the body of Christ at large. The body of Christ here, the body of Christ that we have affiliations with outside the church. Our prayer is that everyone, especially in our church too, would be unified in love. That was Paul's prayer. He wanted everybody to be unified in love. How many know when you have a body, like a little body and an arm is broken? What happens to that body? It's got a little bit of a, you know, it's not going to work the same. That person can't use their arm as much. They're in a cast. That's the way it feels when someone in the body of Christ is not unified. It feels like there's a fracture in the body. And how many know it doesn't just hurt? It hurts everyone. It hurts us and it hurts everyone. Amen. Amen. Our prayer is that the body of Christ will be unified in love.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Love covers a multitude of sin. Amen.
Thank you.
It says, "For I want you to understand, church, what really matters, so that you may live pure and blameless lives until the day Christ returns." We need to love, church, just as if Christ was returning today.
That's right.
I'm going to love. You know what? Why am I hanging on to all this mess and all this past and unforgiveness? What is that going to do? Some people wear unforgiveness like it's a blanket, like it's a whoopee. Get rid of the whoopee. Get rid of it. It's going to make you miserable. So get rid of that. Start to love. Ask the Holy Ghost to help you. Spend time in God's presence so you can be empowered. So your battery can be re-energized. Amen?
Amen.
That's the only way you're going to make it. I don't always have good days. I don't wake up, "Oh, I'm going to love today." I have to seek the Lord to help me. I'm going to just love everybody today. I just feel wonderful. Lord, I'm going to serve you and praise you. I can't wait to get into the prayer closet to pray an hour. No, that's not the way it works. I live in this fleshly body just like you guys do. I have to drag sometimes my flesh into the prayer closet to show God how much I love Him.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I can't wait for the Spirit to lead me. If you're waiting for the Spirit to lead you, you're never going to get into prayer. Amen. Because it's not a leading and it's not a feeling. It's an obedience. Amen.
Amen.
It's a way that we show our love to God, because love is not a noun, it's a verb. Love is an action. It's something that we do. Amen.
Amen.
It says here, "May you always be filled with the fruit of your salvation, the righteous character," there it is, "produced in your life by Jesus Christ. For this will bring much glory and praise to God." Hallelujah. The only way you can develop that character is with the help of the Holy Spirit. The only way we can make that commitment today to walk in love with one another and with the world, as whenever we can be a blessing in some sort of way, is by the help of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
You can't do it in your own flesh. You will fail. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We can't talk about the love chapter or love, the subject of love, without doing 1 Corinthians chapter 13.
Come on, man.
Amen. This is the meat of it all here. We may go one other place too. We'll see what the Holy Ghost says. And everybody go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I want you to start at verse 1 with me. I love this chapter. Whenever you want your love to be energized, just go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Amen?
Amen.
That'll be y'all's homework this week to get y'all's love stirred up. Let's go to verse 1. Everybody with me?
Yes.
"If I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels but didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains but didn't love others, I would be nothing." How many of you know that when a pastor or any pastor that runs a church, when they are not motivated by the spirit of love or by the fruit of love, they will fail.
Amen.
In their ministry. Amen.
Sure.
They have to be the motivating factor for all of us being in here today. I show up to church because I'm showing that I love the Lord. I want to dedicate my time. I want to obligate myself to God by showing up to church. I want to pledge myself to show up to church because I love God and I love the body of Christ. That's how we show our love. Your very presence here is so important. None of you, I didn't say every one of you here, every single one of you has an important place in the body of Christ. Whether you preach, whether you worship, whether you don't do any of those things, simply you sitting in that chair is a love that you all will never understand.
Hallelujah.
Because unless you're a pastor, you can understand that love. It's almost like I say, "Lord, I'm not a natural parent, but if this feels anything like a natural parent, I thank God I'm not a natural parent." Oh, boy. You, I mean, I'm not a natural parent, and sometimes I feel like one.
Wow.
But it's a blessing because I get to understand how a mom would feel.
Amen.
He gets to understand how a dad in the earth would feel. Amen.
Good.
We love people. We love people. That's just what we're called to do. Love people, preach the word, and you all live your convictions. Amen. Amen. That's what we do. Preach the word and you all live your convictions. Hallelujah. So let's go to let's start at verse 2 again. "If I had the gift of prophecy, if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains but didn't love others, I would be nothing." We could have all the gifts. Oh, that pastor, they move all the 9 gifts of the Spirit. He moves in all 5-fold ministry gifts. Wow. But he doesn't love others. He's just making a lot of noise. He's just like a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal. I don't ever want us, any one of us, to be a noisy gong and a clanging cymbal. Amen. I want our love to run deep in this church. I want our love to run deep for one another. Amen.
Amen.
And for the Lord especially. And if I gave everything I have to the poor and even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it. But if I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. Verse 4, I love this. Love is patient and kind. I'm going to stop right there. In that little sentence, there's three fruit of the Spirit. So I want to go to Galatians chapter 5. Go to Galatians chapter 5. That wasn't in my notes, but I got to go there. Galatians chapter 5. Starting at verse 22. Now we know in Corinthians it just said, love is patient and kind. Love is a fruit of the Spirit. Patience is a fruit of the Spirit, and kindness is a fruit of the Spirit. Galatians chapter 5, I believe, starting at verse 22. Everybody with me? And if you're there, say amen, or I got it. It says, but the Holy Spirit, who? The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. So we can't produce this kind of fruit on our own? No. We need the Holy Spirit to help us commit and make this commitment to love. Watch what it says here in the fruit. So here we have love. Love is the first listed. Why? Because it's the most important.
Amen.
Joy. If you have love for one another, you have love for God, you're going to have some joy. You're going to have a little bit of joy, even though you're going through whatever circumstance. Deep down on the inside of you, you're going to have some joy when you're walking in love and you're walking in the Spirit. And the next one is peace. You're going to have peace. What does the Bible say? The kingdom of God is not meat or drink, but righteousness. I'm in right standing. If I'm in right standing and I'm walking with the Lord and I'm in God's will, it's going to produce peace and it's going to produce joy. It's not meat or drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Everybody catch that? In the Holy Ghost. Amen. Because a lot of Christians that walk, they have salvation, they go to church, but they're not full of the Holy Spirit. Amen? They're maybe Spirit-led at times, but they're not Spirit-filled. Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace. What was the other one? Patience. Love is not. Love is kind. Love is patient. Patience. That's probably a hard one for everyone. That's probably the... Don't ever pray, Lord, just... help me with my patience and give me all I can get, because boy, everything in the world will come at you. So be careful when you pray. Say, Lord, help me and strengthen me in the area of patience. Amen?
Amen.
I need peace and I need you to help me walk in the fruit of patience. Amen?
Amen?
And it goes on to say kindness. There it is. There's kindness. Goodness. How many know the Bible says in Proverbs, don't let loyalty and kindness, don't forget about them, but tie them around your neck like a noose. He says, then, if you walk this way, you'll find both favor with God and with man. That's what the Bible says. So it says, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, being faithful, commitment, making a commitment to walk in love. To pledge oneself, to obligate. I am responsible for. I am accountable. Gentleness, verse 23, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Gentleness and self-control. Now, the love that we read about can really be misconstrued, and you can say, oh, I can just, it sounds really like cotton balls and pink clouds and cherries. How many know that love sometimes is going to be tough? Amen. Wasn't Jesus tough when he confronted the woman at the well?
Amen.
Wasn't he tough? He loved on her. Did Pastor Jesse preach the living water? Oh, he's going to go part two next Sunday.
Amen.
He approached the woman at the well because no one else wanted to approach her because she was a half Samaritan and half Jew. So Jesus approached her and he let her know that he was the living water. Am I correct? He let her know all and just loving on her. And then what does he do? After he loves on her, then he comes in and confronts her sin. He says, oh, yo, you have five husbands. You see, that's tough love. That's a con- but us, Jesus. No, we're the representatives of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
When God calls you to do something like that, you better just know you're hearing from the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Most of the time, it's going to be the pastors that do it. But if God leads you because you see an erring brother or sister, you love them so much, don't let them slip away. Come in there and say, you know what? God loves you. Let's get back. Whatever it may be.
Amen.
Amen. So, in other words, because we're Christians doesn't mean we're doormats. You can still speak your mind in a Christ-like way. Amen?
Amen.
Just because you're Christians doesn't mean you just let somebody abuse you and take advantage of your kindness, take advantage of your love, take advantage of those things. Amen? We are all human beings, and there will be a time when you have to speak your mind, and you're going to love, but it's going to be tough at that point. Amen?
Amen.
Now everybody go back with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're going to finish off here. How many of you are getting something out of this love message? My commitment to walk in love. My obligation, I have an obligation to walk in love. I have, I'm making a pledge to walk in love from this day forth. I am pledging myself. I am being responsible for my love walk from this day forth, Pastor Elisa.
Hallelujah.
So let's go back to verse 4. First, we're going to finish off here. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not rude. I'm sorry. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. How many know that if pride sets in to a person, that everything will sprout? Rude, want to do it my way. All these jealous, boastful, gossip, everything will start sprouting out from this root of pride. Amen? So you got to be careful. When pride starts to creep in on you and you realize it's there, just take authority and say, Lord, I ask you to forgive me. I humble myself in the sight of the Lord and you will lift me up. That's how you get rid of pride, because the Bible says God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Amen?
Amen.
So love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It does not demand its own way. Well, the Lord said to do it like this, but I'm going to do it this way. The Word says it's like this, but I'm going to do it that way. The pastor says do it like that, but I'm going to do it this way. But Pastor, I don't understand why I got to do it this way. You don't demand your own way. Amen?
Amen.
Love does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. And it keeps no records of being wronged. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. Verse 6, it does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. That's love. A love that covers. A love that runs deep. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 7. Love never gives up. Love never loses faith. Don't ever give up. There'll be times when God calls you to pray for certain people, and you'll pray for them, and then the Lord says, okay, stop praying. And you'll know when that is. Love never gives up. Amen? He may lead you to pray. He may lead you to pray again another season for that person. But love never gives up.
Hallelujah.
And then it goes on to say, love never gives up, never loses faith. How many know that the only way faith works in your life is it works by love? It works by love.
Amen.
And it goes on to say it's always hopeful and endures through every circumstance.
Amen.
Let me tell you, church, this love walk, this commitment to walk in love will not be easy. It will involve personal sacrifice. It will involve changing your lifestyles. It will involve changing your habits. It will involve changing some of your ways. Amen.
Amen.
But I want you to know that this love walk is possible with the help of the Holy Spirit. Ask Him to help you wherever you are right now. Everybody stand. You can close your Bibles.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing, but am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not blessing.